Well, hello, howdy. Howdy do. What's up? Yo.
Come out wherever you are.
What the heck? Oh. I was like, what is going on? All right. So, when some people join the stream here, I'll kind of do some recaps of what's been done. But other than that, I'm just going to start coding. Checking in some code here for these, I got the Xbox controller mostly working last night. It was a very simple thing, actually, to get it past its, past the bugs that were haunting it yesterday. So I'm just checking over what I did yesterday, and I'm checking it in now, because there's one final thing that has to be done to get this to work right. Yep. Right. This will be good to have this checked in as it's working now. And then this final little cherry on top. Cool. That looks good. So I'm going to specifically check in the input files that I've been editing. Git commit projects classes input star. I think it's just input.h, input controllers. Yeah, that's it. Oh, title scene is also part of that. Abort. Okay, so I'm going to go into the game and I'm going to reset my bindings because there is one issue. If you switch from two different controller types, let's say you start with your Xbox controller, you bind all your keys, then all of a sudden you go and unplug your Xbox controller, plug in a brand new controller. This is like barely ever going to happen, but you basically need to rebind your keys. So I don't think that's not really going to be a real life situation very much. And if somebody does do that, I hope that they have the understanding to basically go rebind their keys. But it does mess things up. Basically, if you bound things to one axis and then you switch your controllers and all of a sudden it has totally different axes, then of course it's not going to work. Okay, so I'm not going to skip the menu. Good, that's all. So the one little issue is with the D-pad. In the D-pad, let's say you do like a Hadouken and you want to swing your controller all the way from one button to another. Or like basically if you go down, left, up, right, and you just move it around in a circle. Oh, I wonder why that. Oh, I must. Oh, yeah, because this is because I had my keys bound last night to the other controller. So let me reset the bindings, and we'll do this right. Okay. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to bind. So here I'm holding up, down, left. Right, A, B, select, start. I'm gonna add my key bindings as well. Whoops. Shoot, I see the select. I meant to do start. Okay. Let's try that again. Okay. Oh, it won't let me bind that one again. Screw it. Key bindings are going to be messed up now. Well, so that's one bug, I guess. I'll write that down in the bugs. If keys Okay, so we need some more bindings now. I need the bindings for the D-pad as well. So I'm holding up here, down, left, right. I can add some more buttons for A and B. Select. Still just select. Okay. So now we're good. We've got the binding set up for the Xbox controller. Things work fine, especially if I'm using the this joystick. No problem moving around. It's all good. Now, and basically what the problem was yesterday, and yesterday's code was that I was pressing, like, basically I would press down to go down, right? But then if I press slightly left, it would count that. So that the joystick suddenly has a value that's like, ooh, negative 10,000 to the left. And that was overriding the other one. So I basically have it now. So if one is at like, this one's at like negative 32,000 and that one's at negative 10,000, then it does the one with the higher value, basically, the higher absolute value. So that was the trick to getting it all to work yesterday. But so the issue now is if I take this D-pad, I go down, left, up. See that? I went from left to up and it doesn't work. So it doesn't smoothly go and let me transition between the two. So I got an idea of how to fix it, which I hope this works and doesn't break the existing. So here in input controllers, I want to make it so it processes each, it processes the actual buttons and held key codes after it receives the joystick input. So this is where we capture the latest input. And so all this function, when it does is it, when it captures the input from the axis, it's not going to use the bindings or set any held key codes unless a key is bound. So if binding is not equal to bindings.end. We could do it like this. And that's it. Basically, I'm not going to need this anymore. All this code, I'm just going to comment all this out here. What's up, professional novice? Yo! How's it going? So I'm going to move this code into the tick. So basically it'll process all the... the latest values in the tick rather than in this capture. Yeah, doing great, man. I finally fixed this Xbox code last night, mostly. And there's one last little issue where if you kind of try and do a Hadouken and you go from like down, left, up, right, all while holding it all down, there's an issue where it doesn't kind of like if I go down and then left, there's an issue where it doesn't, if I go back to down, for example, or I go from down to left to up or whatever, if you go to that third button press, it doesn't recognize it because of what I had to do for this, these latest access value fix last night. So I got an idea how to fix that. I think it's going to work. But other than that, the Xbox controller is working good. So that's awesome. Here we go. So this captures the latest values. This will apply the latest values. Actually, this should be latest and greatest, basically, because yeah, the way this is all working is when one direction is say all the way down, that's like 32,000 as far as like the actual value, and when there's dead zones too, so like it has to cross over 10,000 to actually count as a key press. So when you press down and then you press slightly to the left or slightly to right, that's the bug that I was getting yesterday. So it was counting two directions at once as down. So the solution to that is to use the greatest value. And that's the problem right now with going and trying to do a Hadouken is that I need to keep track of the old latest values. So down, up, right, and or like down, right, up, or down, left, up. Got to keep track of that down value as well as the left value and the up value. So I'm going to loop over all the latest values. Latest axis values. And we need to find the greatest one per greatest value. Of them all, actually. Yeah, okay. We can do this. Actually, I'll probably put this into a function. Yeah, I know, it kind of is tedious, yeah. It is tedious because you know, there's several different ways to accept input, and joysticks are like, you know, they have a lot of different values. But so this is the last step. Once I get this working, it's all good. Okay, so I'll go int greatest axis equals -1. And in greatest value. Yo, what's up? Hey, Sam. Yeah, I just started like 10 minutes ago. I finally fixed the Xbox controllers last night. Nice, man. Cool. Right on. So, Sam and I were working last night. Sam's been working for days on getting the Rapid Game to compile Android on Windows, and I worked a little bit on it last night too, and got version 0.9.8 out, and there'll probably be shortly a 0.9.9 because we got a few more fixes coming in. So that's awesome. And also I upgraded Entity Foo last night, so that was that's pretty cool actually. So Azenris, he was watching the stream yesterday. And Azenris actually submitted a pull request to make Entity Foo better. Check this out. Yo, what's up, somebody? Oh, I forgot to get my laptop so I can see who who just followed. But thank you for following somebody. This is really cool. Azenris submitted this. This is using variadic templates. So this is part of C++ 11. You can pass in an infinite number of different types or classes into a function. And so this is using this variadic template. And it's tricky. I'm not exactly sure how it works. It's very advanced stuff here. But basically, I think what's going on here is it just repeatedly calls add component and then finalizes one last component. So the difference between that what it was before and now is basically before there was like I had four different functions in here, five different functions, something like that, which all took increasing numbers of components. And that was just a really dirty and stupid way to do it if you've got variadic templates. So, and I verified this works on Windows as well. So that's really cool. I know, the magic of Git. Yeah, it totally is. What's up, NutCloud the Randall? Yeah, Git is magic. GitHub is even more magic. It's so cool we can share code together. Oh man, when I grew up, we didn't have any of this stuff. Back when I was a kid, we used to walk uphill both ways. Okay, so what I'm doing here is I got one more upgrade to this Xbox code or Xbox controller code, which will allow a greatest access value to fall back to an older value. So if pair.second, that's the value. Second, right? It's greater than greatest value. And we'll set that one. That's right, kids. Get it straight. Greatest access equals pair.first. Greatest value equals pair.second. There. So that'll establish the greatest value. Greatest access. Here we'll apply it. Oh, this is find. Find latest and greatest access value. Apply the latest and greatest access value. Yeah, and this should definitely be its own function. Yeah, this is getting dirty. This is getting big and long enough to be its own function. So make this its own function. And we're going to pass in bindings. Oh, this is input bindings type. Yay. I think it's going to be a const. Check if that's a const. Bindings, get bindings. Yeah, of course it's a const. All right, cool. So now we've got this as its own function, and we can apply the latest value. We've got the held code. Let's just call this access and val. To keep it consistent with the existing code here. Axis val. And here we'll be safe and say if axis is less than zero, return. So there. If there is no axis with the greatest value, then there's no need to Do anything else. Okay, so we've got to make a code out of the axis value. That's right. What's up, Colleen? Yeah, it is. It definitely is. I haven't played Heroes of the Storm yet. Man, I'm so behind on my game playing. It looks good though. Looks really good. I mean, Blizzard does everything awesome, so. All right, so what I'm gonna need to do is make a simple little function to reuse this right here, where I can grab a code from all these different values here. So let's make a one simple little function for that. Int get, what's this called? This is get access code. Oh, nice. What? Your Mac just broke just now? How'd it break? Azenris, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your submission yesterday. I'm going to re-say how awesome your code was that you submitted. Azenris yesterday submitted a pull request for Entity Foo to use variadic templates, and I barely even understand variadic templates, so thank you for figuring that out. Thank you for submitting that, but it's pretty cool. Entity Foo now uses variadic templates to basically you can create as many different components as you want with the entity create method now. So thank you, Azenris. Awesome code. Everybody knows the meaning of life is 42. Of course. Is it Douglas Adams Day again? Already? I thought we already had that this month or last month. Okay, so we got int axis, int ID. Actually, ID should come first. Int axis. Yeah, high five, Azenris. Good stuff. And once again, thanks to Seaman Roses. Sam is making some awesome changes to Rapid Game. So, thank you. GitHub is so awesome. It's so cool to be able to share code together now. And I hope Entity Foo helps people. I hope Rapid Game helps people. All right, we got int id access int val. Should be enough to figure out. Yeah. So we got an extra code. So this is basically like giving an integer code for a certain controller device, controller axis, and controller value. And now I'm putting this into its own little method too. Cool, nice. Yeah, I highly recommend using an entity component system for any kind of game engine. Sam, are you guys making your game in C++? Just checking over this method. Yeah, that looks good. Looks great. Okay, so we've got. All we need now is int code equals. Oh, cool. Oh, rad. Nice. Oh, of course. Of course. Duh. Right. Nice. Have you tried resetting your what's it called? VPRAM? Try this. This has happened to me before too. Mac reset with PRAM and NVRAM. Yeah, check this out, man. What's the here? Maybe this article here. You might want to look at this. Yeah, and definitely send a screenshot if you got anything to send or any other info. But PRAM and VRAM as well. Reset the V NVRAM. Might want to try these. But read up on these articles first. You want to understand what you're doing. But these might be able to recover what's going on. It totally depends on what the situation is on your laptop, but
Do.
Oh. One sec. My girlfriend wants me to take a picture of the chalkboard. Man, I got a shout out to China, Illinois. If anybody's seen that cartoon, dude, it's so hilarious. I'm like in this flow where I keep on discovering new cartoons, and I love China, Illinois. It's such a funny show. Right. In code equals this get access code arg access there. Ah, it's beautiful when code gets reused like that. Okay. Let's make sure none of this is breaking anything else. Oh, we need the ID. All right, so I gotta refactor this and to use IDs as well as axes. So map int, wait, map int. Map int. It. Okay, so this time I'm gonna do this method like this, int ID. So for each. And this will be latest access values ID. Okay, and then when we loop, this is gonna be a loop now. So for auto ref ID pair in latest access values, use the ID pair dot first. There. Okay, so now this method works based on an ID. Okay, and this is going to get the code, ID, access, val. We've already got access threshold, that's good. Nice, right on. Well, what do you mean by atomicity? In Asinris, where did I miss an ID? Or maybe I already used it. Okay, cool. Now we got binding. We need to find the binding for a code. So that's here. Auto bindings, bindings find code. I think we got this almost right. This is, we don't need to store the values anymore. And then down here, we're going to store these values like this. Okay, so we are gonna need to store the ID really quick. Int ID equals that, ID. Latest access values, ID access equals val, there. Oh. Well, which language are you thinking of there? Okay, the build succeeded, but I want to go over this code and make sure that what I did is conceptually correct. So every time an axis moves, basically now all what it does is just store, it stores the latest value. Oh, right. I know what you mean by atomicity? Forget what, but I know what you mean. Yeah, non-atomic, atomic. What are the other words you can use there? Read-only and all those, yeah. Okay. Oh, we don't need, wait. I guess we do need bindings here. Because we only want to store latest access values if there's a binding, okay. All right, so this is grabbing the latest value. Whenever an axis moves, it grabs the latest value, grabs the ID for that device that's actually submitting this axis value. It turns that axis into axis and ID into a code, which the game can use to uniquely identify that button. And then it checks to see if it actually has a binding for that button. And then if it does, it stores the latest axis value for that axis. And then later, once it's received all of its axis values, it goes and uses the greatest one. So at the end of tick, it goes and loops over all its latest axis values, finds and uses the greatest one for each device. So the device ID is passed in, the bindings are passed in. It goes and loops over all the latest values for that device ID. Pair.second is greater than val. Yeah, pair.second is the value. Pair.first is the axis. Value starts at -1, so everything is pretty much going to be... Whoa. Oh. Okay, I found a bug. Values can be negative. Values range from -32,000 to +32,000, at least in OIS, this thing. So this needs to be if val, this starts at val 0, and this is absolute value of pair.second is greater than vowel. No, it's greater than absolute value vowel. Yeah. Then axis is that, value is that. So this is going to use the greatest value, and that's independent of whether it's negative or positive. But then it stores the actual negative or positive value. Okay, good. I'm glad I just did a check over on that, because that would have been a bug for sure. All right, so once we've got the greatest axis value, we go and look up the code for it. Also look up the held key code, and this is where it's updating the actual held key code. So absolute value is less than axis threshold, and held code equals code. Then we reset the held controller code. Axis is greater than or equal to 0. We don't need to check that anymore because we already did. Oh, not cloud. I grew up on Windows, actually. For, you know, many years, I used Windows. Actually, DOS. I started in DOS. And I programmed games in DOS in 1995. That was MS-DOS 6-point-something. And, or was it 5-point-something? And then, and then Windows came out. That was pretty cool. And then finally, later on in life, I discovered Mac. And I discovered Unix and Linux. I discovered Unix and Linux in college. And then I totally loved Linux. And so when I found out that Mac had its own, when Mac switched over and started using a BSD operating system, I was like, I'm switching. So I switched to Macs, and I've never looked back, because there's such an awesome, powerful underlying operating system underneath it all. So I still have to use Windows because of, you know, publishing the game on Windows, but yeah. I know, right? Well, from our talks yesterday, some of the guys here on the stream were telling me that basically because of patents or something like that, Microsoft had to program their Xbox controller to be different, or they had to design it all to be different. So the way they actually send you input is really crazy, but you know, it's not that difficult to deal with. You just basically have to throw away a lot of values that they keep sending you. You have to ignore stuff that's in a dead zone, which you have to do for every joystick out there. But the trick to Xbox controllers, at least on Mac, is that they're sending you values for every single axis all the time. And so you really have to focus on the one with the greatest value. Raspbian, wow. I didn't know oh yeah, of course Raspberry Pi has that. They just laid off the people working on it? Whoa. What's up, Microsoft? Okay, I think this is right. And then after it does all that, it looks up the binding and sets the value. Okay. Cross your fingers this works, because I don't know if it will. So if this all works, I'll still be able to use my joystick. Oh no, it's getting stuck again. Damn it. Oh. Dang. You pass in some force feedback. And that depends on what library you're using, but in at least in open, what the heck is this thing called? It's called OIS something, but you can pass in some force feedback. I'm not exactly sure to how to do this yet, but I'm going to use their interface for basically you just pass in some values to the controller and it causes it to vibrate. What's up, Bullseye Pie? Yeah, I'm already using one. I'm already using OIS. So that's OIS is basically an open source library for that, for developing controllers. What's up, Big Mac Dev? Yo. Hey, Felix, what's up? So you guys, you just joined the stream. Yesterday, I had the Xbox controller working, except for this one little thing. And now I tried to reprogram it to do that one little thing, and it broke it again. So I'm going to give this like 15 minutes or so. And if I don't fix this in the next 15 minutes, I'm going to move on to working back on the boss doors again. So, okay, to debug what the heck is going on. I don't need this. Okay, I'm going to try and use my intuition here. I'm not relaxed enough. I'm not relaxed enough to use my intuition right now. Lord of mercy, what's a programmer to do? I know it has something to do with this. Hey, welcome to the stream, Boofy. Maybe. No, I don't think so, because it is able to do up and down, and I'm already using absolute value in, I think, in the right cases, so so I can press down once. Oh. I can go up or down. So I know that the values are at least being correct in some sense there, but somehow it just gets stuck like that. So we look at these values. Am I checking them versus the threshold? Oh, that might be it. Oh. Yeah, I think this might be it right here. I forgot to even check about the threshold for this, for using the bindings. But why did that work before? Before in my existing code. Oh, of course. Because set axis buttons does check the thresholds. Not cloud. What do you mean? Can you give an example of what you're talking about? So this is set axis buttons right here, and this does check if the value is less than or greater than. Okay, I'm gonna switch up my verbosity so it uses flags. All right, well, I'm not sure exactly what you're asking there. Okay, so I'm going to make verbosity unsigned. I'm going to go and add different flags that can be added into verbosity. So this is K verbose buttons. And I'm going to use a Mars of power here. Calling this the Mars of power. Okay, well this totally depends on your engine. What game engine are you using? Yo, what's up, Chaos? The game's going great, man. It's going really, really great. I'm just trying to fix up this issue with these controllers. But I'll show you the game in a second there. I'm working on these cool boss doors. Actually, I'll just show you right now. Whoa. I think I got my keys bound wrong. Oh, no, that's okay. So, yeah, I'm working on Xbox controllers today. And I had this idea to fix this one last little bug, and so far it's not quite working. But later on, after this, I've got about 10 more minutes to try fixing this Xbox controller. And then I'm going to go back to working on these big old boss doors. So these boss doors are going to be something where you have to solve a puzzle, like elsewhere in the dungeon. You'll defeat some really difficult room or solve a puzzle or something like that. And that will allow these boss doors to open up and you're going to go into the boss room. So it's just adding a little bit more variety to the game. Right now, the boss doors, the boss doors were simply just another key. So like this door over here, this yellow door is a key-based door. And before, the boss doors were also key-based doors. But it's kind of boring to just go get like two or three keys in a level. So it's a little more interesting to have these special doors that are only for the boss and require some kind of either wit or, you know, force to get in there. Hey, welcome to the stream, Coach Barrow. Thanks for the help there. Yeah, are you listening there, NotCloud? Good advice here. Yeah, Bullseye Pie. Yeah, Bullseye Pie, I'm already using it. It's called OIS. It's an open source library that you use to process feedback or input from your controllers. But the thing is, even though I'm using this open source library, I still have to take its data and apply it to my game in a unique way. So all I'm doing is I'm just taking joystick data and applying it to Songbringer in a special way, because I already had it written for simple controllers like this. These things are so simple, so easy, and when you press left, it's a very easy thing to process. It's just that Xbox controllers return a lot of complicated data. So there's no more. I'm already using an open source library for that. I just need to figure out how to handle the data, because basically what's going on is Xbox controllers send you an overwhelming amount of data. They send you data for, there's six different axes here. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different axes that it's returning values for, and it returns values every single tick. So you're getting like all this data, and you have to just basically figure out which one's what. And so it's simple. It's really actually pretty simple in the end. You just got to focus on the greatest data or the greatest couple different pieces of data. And I know it does seem like I'm struggling here, but it's always kind of difficult for me to debug detailed code like this while I'm live streaming. But I wanted to show you guys what's up, what I've been working on. So, oh, cool, you're using Unreal, right on. Mars of Power, what's up? Chaos, yeah, the release date is going to be either January, February, March, so quarter one of 2016, and that's all the info on this is on the info page for my live stream. You can check all it out there, or you can just go to songbringer.com and it's got more details there. Songbringer.com's got details on also, it's got all the details. If you just basically click on, there's a link to the Kickstarter. The Kickstarter has all the super duper details on everything. Code Sparrow, yes, I stand in code. Yeah, I know, right? Yeah, that's why I put it as part of the FAQ, but nobody reads the FAQ, so. Felix, you can. I don't foresee any issues right now because I don't know much about Windows 10. But as a developer, you can go, if you really want to be detailed about it, you can go and download the latest beta and try out your code. But I'm just not going to do that because it's my game's launch is still going to be, 6 to 7 months away. So I'm just going to keep developing it for Windows 7 and 8 right now, and then I'll check it later to make sure it works on Windows 10 when it comes out officially. Is it already officially out? I don't even know. Oh, Mars of Power. Well, cool. I'm looking forward to seeing you, man. Maybe I can join you guys for that hike you're going on in in your woods. I could like bart over to the city and join you that way and bring your poster. Propose buttons. Okay, buttons, thresholds, and axes. How do you spell the plural of axis? Is oh it's oh right it's axes with a ES. Nice. Oh, cool. Awesome. Well, cool. We'll keep in touch. We'll keep in touch. Okay, so now what I'm doing is I'm breaking down the actual verbosity into flags so that I can turn them individually on and off. Because what I want to do is see the actual data for buttons being pressed. Right now, that's not possible with the current verbosity settings. I know. Oh, axes with a, an apostrophe. All right. So I don't need to worry about that. I can go verbosity equals k verbose buttons or k verbose axes, k verbose thresholds. Gonna turn this off. This was putting a space in for every tick. Okay, so for vote verbosity and k verbose thresholds. This one is verbose buttons. Yeah, chaos, totally. Yeah. Steam Greenlight. So we're good to go for Steam Greenlight. The game's coming out on Steam. sometime quarter one of 2016, so like either January, February, or March. And then since the Kickstarter did so well, it's also coming out on iOS for sure. That's awesome. And also there's going to be local co-op, so the girl character is going to be playable. I haven't worked on her in a minute, but she is going to be a playable character. She's going to be a support character, so she's actually invincible, but she has these certain powers that kind of affect enemies without hurting them. So she's basically just a support character. But here's Vel. She's the female character that'll be playable. CodeSparrow, this is a one-man project. I make all the code, I make all the art, and I make all the music. So it's actually my first project. I've ever done all of it myself, and I'm very, very excited about it. It's amazing to be able to finally be at the point in life where I can do all of these things. For many years, I didn't have the skills to do art, and now I finally can do art. So it's like, yes, I can make my own game completely myself. And it's not just me. I'm not alone. So, you know, it's having this live stream with you guys commenting on it every day and submitting like suggestions and your ideas and sending money to help out with like the Kickstarter and pre-ordering the game and stuff like that. I'm not alone. It's thanks to you guys that this game is becoming as cool as it is. You know, some of the best ideas for the game have come from the live stream, like item crafting, for example. On scale. Oh man. I guess it's only a 6. Cause I know it's not the Xbox controller's fault. It's just my own code and trying to sift through all the data. So this one is Axies. Yep, exactly. And when I finally started making art and I started getting compliments on my art and stuff like that, I finally went and rewrote a little, or like did a little mini series on it. It's called From Programmer to Artist. So this is my advice on anyone that's interested in learning to make art, but you're maybe holding back for some reason. All right, Chaos, see you, man. What's up, Pema? Howdy, welcome to the stream. I got about 5 more minutes here to try and fix this issue with the Xbox controllers. And if not, I'm sure it's just one simple little thing. I'll figure it out tonight. So let's see if I can get it fixed though. And K-verbose thresholds. Or yeah, totally. Have I replaced the mouse? No, I haven't. I still have a janky mouse and a janky keyboard. And I'm looking for advice on suggestions. If anybody has suggestions on a better keyboard than the freaking Mac keyboard, look how frayed that is. It's so frayed. But yeah, I'm still using this old thing. But one of the first things I did with the Kickstarter money was to buy an Xbox controller. So I am trying to spend the money wisely, use it all for development. But yeah, one of the things I will probably spend some money on is getting a good keyboard. Do I love to take photos? I do love to take photos, but I don't do it enough. I rarely ever have a phone on me or a camera, so I kind of rely on my friends to actually take the photos when we do fun stuff. Nice, right on, Sam. Yeah, I know. I make dinner at midnight as well, and my girlfriend's always like, "What? You're making dinner? It's midnight." Okay, good. There. All those verbosities are now the how they should be. Nice, cool. Yeah. Did you find a solution for a bag or some kind of like sleeve or something like that for your DLSR? DSLR, what is it? Hey, what's up? Hey, thanks, Binary Pig Studio. Okay. So it's got stuck. It already got stuck. Why did it already get stuck? So here's the data. Yeah, see, this is not even. Oh, okay, so maybe it's not resetting the data because. Oh! Duh. Okay, I get it now. Basically, it's not turning off the data. It's not turning off the axis. Oh, I got it. I think I got it. Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, so Code Sparrow, the elevator pitch about this game is it's like Zelda 1, The Legend of Zelda, the very first one, but it's procedurally generated and there's item crafting. So you enter a six-letter world code when you start. Oh shoot, I sorry, I just refreshed my chat window instead of running the game. But you enter a six-letter world code when you start, so check this out. This is the game. You enter in a six. Oh, dang it. I keep pressing the wrong buttons. You enter a six-letter world code though, and that generates your entire world based on those six letters. So you can also choose between regular and permadeath mode. But if I do regular mode and I want to do like code jib, whatever, and then that starts a world basically based on those letters. And what's cool about that is it doesn't matter whether you're playing on Windows, Mac, Linux, or whatever, but it will generate the exact same world with that same world seed. So you can share if you want to play a brand new world with absolutely totally new content, you enter a new world seed. If you want to play the existing world that you know already and you love and you can fly through it at like a speed run pace, then and you know all the secrets for it. Then you can do that too by entering in the same code. Thanks, Midlick. Yes, it uses a combination of Perlin noise and procedural lock and key puzzle generation and a maze generator. So there's like three different things, but all of it is based on a deterministic random number generator that always gives you the same random numbers depending on whatever seed you give it. So, I think the problem with this controller code is in here that if a value is less than. Like, basically, it just needs to apply the buttons twice. So, like this. I think this is all it needs. Yeah, QK, I'll show you right now. Let's see if this works with this new controller. If not, I'll just play with the keyboard. But yeah. Okay, cross your fingers that it works. Come on, Xbox controller. Oh, I think it did. Oh, yeah. Oh, no. Wait, did it get stuck there? No, it didn't. Yes, this is so sweet. I think it worked. Okay, if I do a Hadouken. Oh, the Hadouken works. Oh, nice. I think this is that fixed it. Awesome. So I've got accurate controls once again with the it's not getting stuck or anything. And can I do a Hadouken? Oh no, the Hadouken doesn't work. Dang it. Okay. There's still some kind of bug. All right. I'll work on that later. I'll just play with the keyboard for now. Yeah. yeah. Let me start over a brand new game. Wait a minute. Oh, the keyboard bindings are even wrong. Yeah, I'll start a brand new game. So, oh, damn it. I just refreshed my chat window again. Oh, I'm a mess today. Yeah, sorry, you guys. I'm going to show you the game from the beginning here. And I'm going to reset my bindings. Brand new game, right? I mean, like a brand new, you know. Okay. Let's start a world. Oh, what seed should I use? Somebody give me six letters. I need six letters to generate a brand new world. I'm totally open here. What should I do? Bread? Penis? all right, Ziri, you got the first one to chat, so we're gonna go with penis. Penis. Sigwin, Pontus. Welcome to the stream, Pontus. Random's a good one. Random, that's cool. And Niblick, sucker. Breads. So the story to this game is you're part of this intergalactic ship that flies around looking for places to party. That's really all this is. So the reason you're in this party attire is that because you've been partying on your ship and then you went and crashed your bike on this planet. And, nice. So your friend here is, you got this friend that's a robot here. His name is Jib. The hero's name is Rock. There is going to be story. So, I haven't actually gotten to write any of the code for the story yet, but there'll be dialogue and story and everything. But you basically, it's a lot like Zelda 1. So you can tell you're starting off on a screen. It's somewhat like Zelda 1 where there's a cave right at the very beginning. And it's also like Zelda 1 in the sense that there's never any scrolling when you're on one screen. So I have no items or anything right now. Oh, I should only have three hearts or three health, but I've got that hacked into my code right now to give the player full health. But you get the point. It should be like Zelda 1. And so you go in this cave, you get your sword. No, you get the sword. Yeah, so the whole plot to this game is that you're partying on this planet on your ship, and then you go down to the surface. You find this sword, but unbeknownst to you, the sword triggers the awakening of this ancient evil army that was locked on this planet by the sword. So, this is one of the evil guys waking up here. It's just supposed to give you the feeling that there's some evil now that's awakened. What's up, Ladder Thief? Scare the birds. Let's see if I can find the actual level entrance. This is fun doing a playthrough. I haven't done a playthrough in a minute. And I'm playing with Vim keys right now. This is like kind of a new thing for me. Yeah, this is all Kogo Sudi. Yeah. I know, right? Yeah, I'm working on guitar riffs. I actually had tendonitis in my left hand, so I couldn't play guitar for many of the beginning of this game. But now I'm finally almost healed, so I can start playing guitar again, get some really cool riffs in. Yeah, the PC, Mr. Tim. Yes, it will be available on iOS and Android too if the game gets enough pre-orders. So you can pre-order the game at songreader.com, and all of that money from the pre-orders counts towards getting the game on Android, PlayStation 4, and Xbox. So I've raised $15,000 so far on Kickstarter, and if I can raise up to 30, then I've got enough to basically do Android, PlayStation 4, and Xbox. Those platforms are just going to take a lot of extra testing time. Yeah, Born to Snipe, I got the Xbox controller working mostly, and welcome back to the stream. But I've got one last little bug, and I tried to fix it just now in the beginning of this stream, but I couldn't quite get it working. But I'm close. I'm really, really close, and probably by tonight I'll have that working. So what I'm doing now is I'm running around the overworld looking for the first world entrance. And what you're seeing here is this is like only 30% done. The game is still very, very early stages. It's pre-alpha. In fact, the very first alpha will be like the end of June, end of this month, and it won't even be complete at that point. So the first betas are going to start happening in like September and stuff like that. So that's about when the game will start getting complete. So what you're seeing here is there's only a few enemy types. There's only one boss type. There's only one art style for the overworld. There's only one art style for the levels. But all of that stuff is getting... is what I'm working on right now. You're guessing shark teeth, Miblick? Yeah, they're based on shark teeth. They're demon's teeth, actually. Uzis? Yeah, you get demon's teeth, and that gives you courage. So your health is actually courage. Oh, I started off my game. Like I said, I hacked my save game to give me full health, and that's why I have all these demon's teeth. I also have a bomb container. So I'm looking for the first level. I don't know where it is because we're using the world Pinis. I could cheat and look at my debug output to find where the level is. But I'm not doing it. Yo, what's up, Alex Pita? How does the map system work? It just keeps track of where you're at. So it keeps track of all the level or the screens that I've been to so far, and that's it. Does each button return their own range for the Xbox controller? Yes, each one does return its own range. And that's what's so tricky about making the Xbox controller work is that it sends you the input for every single range, every single tick. So, what you're saying about Professional Novice, yes, there's an option to have a full-on Zelda-style HUD. So, let me, actually, I'll quit the game really quick and I'll show you that. So I'll turn off the full health, and I'll turn on the full HUD so you can see what that's supposed to look like. Cool, thanks, Biblic. Yeah, Mars of Power. Code Sparrow, no, it's actually a one-dimensional array with or a map. It's actually a map that has a list of the key value in the map is the actual point, the 3D point. So it whoops. So the map, the key value is a map, so each X, Y, Z point. The Z point is the actual level. And the XY is the actual, 2D point in the current area, map or area or whatever. That's the key. And then the value is whether it's been visited or not. So let's see if we can find the first level. Oh, did I already go this way? No. Okay, I haven't been this way. Where's level one? Cool, Mr. Tim. What kind of tutorials are you looking for? Swing and a miss. Oh, here's a little recharge. So you can tell the overworld needs a lot more love. Like, there's going to be a lot more fun stuff. There's going to be waterfalls, there's going to be cliffs, there's going to be mountains, there's going to be more enemy types, there's going to be story elements that you'll be able to find. There's going to be so many secrets, secret caves, secret puzzles, things like that. Oh, with Kokos, right on. Oh, look at this. There's a bug. I can't pass there. Okay. Let's just go around. What's up, Dodge Whale? Good question. Not really. I used to think you had to be particularly good at math to be a programmer, but no. As long as you have a basic knowledge of geometry, you're good. Alex Pita, no, the blobs can't move on water. Was there one of them moving on water? Was it the reflection? Dude, I can't believe I haven't found a single level. Where the hell am I? Oh, I kind of got blocked off on all this because of that bug. Okay. Do you see bombs? Yeah. Yeah, the game has bombs already, but they can't blow up. Bombs don't work to blow up every single kind of rock. But that's another fun thing I'm going to add, is secret rocks where you can blow them up. Oh, man. Oh, cool, Mr. Tim. So is Mars Power is going to WDC too. Oh, yeah, Codes Pro, that's a good point. It's a very good point. You know, certain kinds of programming, you definitely need to know math. But I think if you're talking about game development in general, if you're doing 2D games, I think you really need to know geometry well and algebra, of course. If you're going to do 3D games, you need to know about vectors and things like that. But other than that, you don't really need to know calculus. I mean, it helps to know calculus, especially for 3D stuff. But if you're using a 3D engine, most of it, that's going to be handled for you already. And man, I can't believe I haven't found a single level. Well, okay, I'm going to give this another couple minutes, and then if I don't find a level, I'm going to go back to coding. What's up, Zog Games? How you doing today? Yeah, Mars Power, Mr. Tim's going to WWDC too. Yes, yes, Mr. Tim, right. Okay, this better be a level. All right, nice, it is level. And baking, yeah. Pontus, yeah, I'm using Cocos 2DX. That's the game engine I'm using. But on top of that, I'm using Entity Foo. It's an entity component system I wrote for this game and then published on GitHub. So that's a link to that's on my little profile. So if you look at my Twitch profile info there, the channel info or whatever, it does have a link to Entity Foo. Well, check this out. We got bombs now. Nice. Blew up that. Yeah, I got more bombs. Woo! Feel a little off? Yeah, I know. I hear you. I feel like I feel a little off like a few times every week. Oh, okay, I see what's happened with the health. I shouldn't have this much health, but because I hacked in some extra health to start this game, it gave me all the health upgrades and then saved the game that way. So that's why when I turned off the extra health, it didn't reset it. Good job, Jim. Totally empty room. All it's got is some blobs. Yeah, so you get the point. This is kind of what the game's like. It's like Zelda 1, basically. So now we got this. Yeah, I bet it's expensive. Oh, cool. I forgot there. I added these corridors. That's crazy. This corridor has a pretty tricky situation here. Helmet. Nice. I haven't even written the item for the helmet yet. Why did I get a helmet right here, though? Yeah, it's in the build. There should be some falling floors around here somewhere. Let's look around and see if we can find some of them. Also, the boss doors. Those are in the build, but they're going to block me from the boss right now. Yellow password. Ooh, there might be a hidden item in here. Ah. Yeah, I was sleep coding. That's right, Felix. Yeah, hidden item. Nice, I thought there was going to be one in here. Biodetector. Whoops. So I'm going to use the biodetector and that'll show me where the boss is. Oh, down there. No, that's not where it is. The biodetector's broken. I got to fix that still. That's a bug. But it's supposed to show me where the boss is. This is kind of fun playing the game. Oh, here's the boss room. Nice. So yeah, it's blocked off. I should be able to get through this, but I'm working on this right now. So actually, I'm going to go and start working on that right now after I finish this playthrough. I'm trying to see if I can at least show you guys some falling tiles. They're supposed to be... Every once in a while, there's rooms where the tiles just all fall away. Yeah. You know what? This might be a secret right here. Oh, it is. That's a secret right there. I can't believe I'm so intuitive. Either that or I just programmed the game so I know. Oh, that's a bug. So it looks like it broke the secret walls at some point. Gotta fix that too. Yeah, I like the corridors too. They're really fun. They add kind of a nice contrast to the levels. Although I want them to not be as difficult. You know what? I'm gonna guess this item is the top hat. Please be the top hat, because it's my favorite item. Oh, cactuses! That's another thing about this game is you have these things called these cactuses, and when you eat the cactus, you get these psychedelic powers, and it'll show you where secret walls are. So you'll be able to see, like, oh, there's a secret wall there, I can bomb there, and that's what the cactuses do. They give you psychedelic powers. Oh, there's still one more. Yeah, I like the corridors too. And they're not all of them are going to be that difficult. So, you know, so far you've seen corridors, which is tons of those trap enemy guys. And they're going to be... There's going to be less of those, basically. Because I want some of the corridors to just be totally empty. To give you a lot of more contrast in these levels. Because most of the levels so far are just full of enemies everywhere. Looks like there's one more. One more little hallway down here I missed. I wonder why it gave me the proton helmet thing. You guys are brutal. If I didn't have full health, I would have died there. Gigantic paints. Oh, now that's cool. That's a good idea. Paint on the walls. I love it. There's gonna be a lot more music in the game too. So you guys heard it one of the tracks, but there'll be a lot more, and there'll be a lot more ambiences you can hear. Right now, you can't really hear the ambiences very well because you're hearing the sound come through my laptop speakers, and the sounds are pretty quiet. But with headphones on or a good speaker system, you're gonna hear this nice eerie ambience in these levels. And Easter eggs, yeah, there's definitely going to be a lot of Easter eggs. The cake is a lie. In-game baking simulator. I love it. I love the thought of Jib being your baking assistant. It's got to have a picture of Mars of Power, though. Can I get a little help? Yeah. Definitely. That'll just add contrast, you know? Well, this level has definitely been a unique one. Yes, yeah, Alex Pita, for sure. Yep, I tried to design it that way already, but, you know, there's not really that many items that have been put in here yet, so there's definitely going to be a lot more. items added, and yes, making them proportional to the actual boss that you're dealing with. Okay, so the boss actually is here. Wow. Oh, Azenris, one sec. Yeah, Azenris, that's a really good question because I'm not sure exactly what I'll do for different ratios. But for, as far as zooming goes right now, like when the screen shakes and when the player, when it zooms in, it actually doesn't, it just shows black on the edges. So, but I am going to add some more content around things, I think. So like on iPad, iPad will be a different ratio. So it'll have to have some more content to show. And then also when you're doing these screen shakes and stuff like that, you kind of need to see things besides just black. So I'm going to add just some more visual content only around the edges to be able to do better zooms. Yeah, Taiho, yep, the boss is really cheesy. This guy is actually really easy to beat. So what I'm going to do to fix him is actually he's going to stay in a side. He's either going to be on the left or the right. And so he'll always be attacking out in front of him. And so he'll be a lot smarter and a lot better of a boss at that point. But I want him to be pretty easy. So, oh, I already got the health. So this is supposed to take me out of the level right here, but since I already got the health. But what I'm going to do eventually is have a portal so it warps you back to the beginning right here. By a Jib action figure? Yeah. Oh, that's an interesting idea, Mars Power. You get hit so hard that you get knocked into a different room. Yeah. Oh, and it'll be a cool challenge for speedrun. Let me write this idea down. It's a really cool idea. Okay, so there you go. There's the playthrough. All right, so I'm gonna take a quick little break. I'll be right back, and then I'll get to working on these boss doors again. And tonight I'll fix up the code with the Xbox controller. Finally. So I'll be right back. Right. Pontus, yeah, I did the shadows with shader. So I wrote my own shader. It took I probably put about 2 full weeks of development just into shaders and lighting. So yeah, there's some definitely some good links. A really good link for doing your own shaders is Shader Toy. Shader Toy has some great examples of shaders, and it runs online and shows you some rad. Look at this. This is rad right here. Super cool stuff. But also there's Shaderific. This is some really, really good info on doing shaders here. Let me post these links for you, Pontus. Shaderific and Shader Toy. Yeah. It does, yeah, you know what? I forgot that so far, Felix. Thank you. Thanks for reminding me. I forgot to do that one. This is slowing down my whole laptop here, just running this shader toy. Ah, better. Oh yeah, there you go. Yeah, and that's also a good link there. You can check out my old videos. I forgot. Yeah, I do. I've streamed a lot of these videos and doing these effects and stuff. Cool. Okay, so if I turn, okay, I'm gonna turn. Put my settings back to put me in the room for the boss room so I can keep on working on those boss doors. Yeah, I'm gonna set my initial HP really high. I'm gonna turn off skip or turn on skip menu. Should be it. I should be able to just run it now and I should be in the boss room again. I know, right? So many ideas on there. I can't wait to get to working on those. What's up, Proton Gaming? Right, cool. So we have the boss door. You know what? I'm gonna animate it. I'm gonna animate it right now. Work on some art. Yeah. Totally, right? Where I just totally work on ideas. That's a good idea. I should write down that idea. No. But yeah, that's a good suggestion there to have an idea where I just or have a day where I just work on ideas. Oh, nice one, Felix. I get it. 'Cause when you play Mario, it's always like Princess Zelda's in the next castle, promise for sure. Next time you get there, you're good to go. Trust me. Princess Zelda's there. Okay, so tell me what you mean, Lighter Thief. Arcane, what's up? Yeah, I worked on Xbox controller earlier today and I almost got it working. I still got a bug left. But please do not disturb. Boss door. So, Lighter Thief, where does the perspective look off? Is this top bit not tall enough, maybe? I'm gonna paint that right now. Please do not disturb. Just as a joke. Maybe it'll actually be a part of the game in some boss levels. It gets worse every school year. Arpen, hello, Arpen. Why you're not working, Arpen? What? No. Is my bamboo dead? What's wrong with it? It's maybe because my Xbox controller is plugged in too. This cannot be. Oh my god, I'll be lost without my art pen. Restroom. Oh, the top floor of the wall meets the door. Wait, the top, wait, say it again. Oh, okay. No evil inside? Definitely no evil inside? Yeah, letter thief. But I'd love to know more about what you're saying there. What the heck happened to my tablet? Come on, tablet. Come back to me. Come back to life. I really want to draw. Oh my god. I think my bamboo's dead. Oh, either that or the USB cord's messed up. Man, what the... Oh man, I'm so sad. What the hell? It just magically stopped working. Oh, what am I gonna do? Paint with my mouse? I'm in shock and awe right now. What's this little bit? Oh, I've never taken it apart before. I wonder what that's for. Dude, I hope I don't have to get another one. Knock and wait. Try it on another machine. Good idea. Good idea. Okay, I'll be right back. I'm gonna try it on my girlfriend's laptop. Dude, it doesn't work. Lame! Maybe it'll just start magically working later on today. If not, I guess I have to order another bamboo. Yeah, like, are you talking about this little last little couple pixels? These couple pixels here at the very top? I think I know what you mean there. Proton. Probably programming takes more time. But it depends on how much art you're doing. All right. I guess I'm gonna try and make some art with my mouse. The whole line? Yeah, right. You're talking about this gray line on the side of there. So there's the red door, and then the gray line next to it doesn't quite go all the way to the top. Is that all you mean? Because that's pretty simple thing to add. Mouse art, what? Oh. I'm up in arms over here. Okay, but I'll add a nice little screen or like a sign that can hang on here. We'll do got a big old sign. Intel inside. Kids playing. I like Intel inside. It's pretty funny. Do not disturb. Never use Xbox. It might have, but it didn't work on my girlfriend's laptop either. I'm so sad. I trust the art pen. Might have to order another one. At least we got 2-day shipping with Amazon Prime. Thank God for that. Let's see it. Let's see this. Gonna be on both doors, though. No way out. Xbox curse. Wash your hands before you go back to work. One way. It's backwards on the other one. Okay, well, yeah. Let me start animating this door, these gears. Even though it's only with my mouse. What a downer, man. One day you're working happily, you're working on your game, your favorite tool's doing great. Next day, it breaks. Okay, so I'm gonna need a couple different layers for the gears. I know. Why did I put the sign there? Because it's fun. Yeah, Ziri just suggested you should put a sign that says do not disturb. And it was fun, so I did that. I'm not sure if this probably won't actually be part of the game. But maybe it will. Maybe it will be part of some bosses or something like that. So let me animate this gear by... Oh, man. All my favorite things are so difficult with a mouse. Like selecting things with the lasso. Okay, so that's one gear frame there. Oh, there you go. You can only see it if you use the cactus. Oh, now that would be sweet. I like it. I like it. That'd be a sweet animated gift to show people, too. Eating the cactus and it shows the sign on the door. Okay, I'm thinking... One frame, it goes, so it probably needs 8 frames for these gears spinning, right? One frame, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, 8 frames. Yeah, because otherwise it'll just look kind of crazy. It'll look weak. Okay, so... I'm going to start with a diagonal frame. Stop to use the cactus. What's up, Oblitizard? Oh, I can't give you very good feedback on that because I've only used Unity. I have not used Unreal Engine. However, I've heard really good things about Unreal Engine. And I know isn't Unreal Engine C++? I would use Unreal Engine... just because it's C++. So, and their scripting looks really, really awesome. Yeah, Taiho, this is really, Taiho, awesome. This is kind of what I would have said too. Unity is kind of more beginner friendly, but Unreal does look really, really awesome. And looks like it has a lot of power. Okay, diagonal frame. Oh man. Once again, I have to use this. So if I rotate this 45 degrees. Hey, thanks for following somebody. Sorry, I don't have my iPad out to see who just followed, but thank you for following. Whoa, that looks really messed up. Only 45 degrees. What if it was 90? Yeah, 90 looks okay. 45. Why is it so crappy? Oh, does it? Welcome to the stream, Devil Robot. Yeah, that was horrible. Maybe because... Yeah, maybe because of that.
He keeps texting me.
There. So just selecting that, let's see if that works, if I can now rotate this just 45 degrees. Oh my god, it looks horrible. Okay, I guess I'll have to do this all manually. Eight times 90 degrees? Well, that... I could do four times 90 degrees. What do you mean, a blitzer? What do you mean for the developer? You mean higher system requirements? Oh, thank you, Lighter Thief. Thanks for this visual feedback. Oh, there. The edge in the red circle breaks the illusion for me. In the red circle? You mean the gear? Thank you, Liar Thief. Mm-hmm. Come on, Imager. Come through for us. Cool. What the heck happened? Did my internet go down? Oh no.